All right, this is section 4.4. Here we're going to be talking about how to find x-intercepts of polynomial functions. So it's theorems about zeros. And remember that zeros is synonymous with x-intercepts. All right, so there is this thing. It's kind of fundamental. It's called the fundamental theorem of algebra. And one statement of it, I mean, there's several equivalent forms of it, is that if you have a polynomial of degree n with n bigger than or equal to 1, then we have at least one zero in the set of complex numbers. So then that means that there is at least one zero, at least one, yeah, zero, and it could be complex, I guess. Another kind of equivalent statement of the fundamental theorem of algebra says the following, that if you have a polynomial of degree n, then you can factor out your polynomial into n linear factors. They might not be unique. They might not be unique. Some of them could repeat. So then that means you had a polynomial of degree n, then you should end up with n linear factors. And again, some of them might repeat themselves. That's okay. That just means that they're squared or to the third power or something like that. And here you could have a coefficient, a constant in the front of it all. All right, so what does that say to us? I guess that says that if we're dealing with a polynomial, let's say we're dealing with a polynomial of degree 4. That means that we should be able to factor this polynomial of degree 4 into 4 linear factors. So a polynomial of degree 4 should be able to be expressed as a multiplication of 4 linear factors. A polynomial of degree 5 should be able to be expressed as a multiplication of 5 linear factors, and so on and so forth. That's what the fundamental theorem of algebra is telling us. It guarantees us that that's the case. Okay, sometimes your linear factors might include complex numbers, yeah? And the thing about, the thing to be aware of complex number solutions to polynomial equations is that they always come in pairs. So if a complex number a plus bi is a zero of a polynomial function f of x with real coefficients, then its conjugate a minus bi should also be a zero of the polynomial. So for example, if 2 plus 7i is a zero of my polynomial function f of x, then 2 minus 7i should also be a zero. Yeah. So complex numbers always come in conjugate pairs. They always come in conjugate pairs. All right, so anytime that you have a polynomial and you want to find, you set it equal to zero because you want to find maybe the x-intercepts, and in the process of setting it equal to zero, you discover that there are some complex solutions. Well, the complex solutions should always come in pairs, the complex number and its conjugate. Okay, there is this issue also of irrational zeros. So irrational zeros are things like, well, irrationals. Let me just kind of remind you. So irrationals are numbers, are decimals that cannot be expressed as a fraction. So they cannot be expressed as a fraction. They're not like 2/3. So some examples of irrationals are things like the square root of 2. The square root of 3, the square root of 5, the square root of 7, all of those are irrationals. But then there are also interesting, some other interesting irrational numbers, such as e, pi, things like that. Yeah. So these are irrationals. These types of numbers cannot be expressed as a fraction. In the more general form, the more general form is of the form a plus b square root of let me kind of write it the way it's written here. A plus C square root of B. This is an irrational number where B is not a perfect square. And if you end up with an irrational solution, so if you end up with an irrational zero to a polynomial f of x, then its conjugate, a minus c square root of b, should also be a zero of your polynomial. So irrational solutions also come in conjugate pairs. So complex zeros come in conjugate pairs. Irrational zeros also come in conjugate pairs. So if a plus c squared root of b, where b is some prime number or something, not a perfect square. So if that is a solution to a polynomial function, then a minus c squared root of b should also be a zero of your polynomial. Okay, so let's put these three ideas to work for us right now. Let's get into some exercises here. All right, so let's see. They gave us a little bit of information here. So what they told me is that four zeros of a polynomial function of degree 7. So they gave me four of the zeros of my polynomial. The polynomial is supposed to be of degree 7. It's supposed to have rational coefficients, so then the coefficients should be fractions, perhaps. And the zeros that they gave me are negative 2 plus 5i, negative 2i, 1 minus the square root of 3, and 8. What are the other zeros of this polynomial function of degree 7? All right, so given zeros, so the given zeros were negative 2 plus 5i, negative 2i, and 1 minus the square root of 3, and 8. Those are the ones that they gave us. And now they're asking me, what are the other ones? So unknown zeros. Those are the ones that we gotta come up with ourselves. So what are these two unknown zeros? So it's a polynomial of degree 7, yeah? Also keep that in mind. So for instance, let's pause for a second also here. Since 8 is a zero of my polynomial, so let me kind of over here on the side kind of mention something. So I'm gonna say 8 is a zero of f of x. Okay, that's equivalent to saying that x minus 8 is a linear factor of f of x. Those two things are equivalent, yeah? So 8 is a zero means that x minus 8 is a linear factor. Over here, x minus this whole complex number is a linear factor. X minus this other complex number is a linear factor. X minus this irrational number is a complex factor. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4 linear factors. If I was to multiply these four linear factors, I would end up with a polynomial of degree 4. Yeah, does that make sense? So let's see. Let me just kind of think about it right now. So right now we have these following linear factors. So from the given zeros, I have the following linear factors. X minus negative 2 plus 5i. That's a linear factor of my polynomial. Also, x minus negative 2i is also a linear factor of my polynomial. X minus 1 minus the square root of 3 is also a linear factor of my polynomial. And x minus 8 is a linear factor of my polynomial, yeah? And if you think about it, so these are all the linear factors of this polynomial of degree 7 that we're hunting for. If you were to think about this, if I multiply these four linear factors, if I actually was to expand all of this out, which would be messy, I would end up with something with a degree 4, because you would have x times x times x times x 4 times. So what are the other? So then that means that I should have three other factors. I should have three other linear factors of my polynomial so that I do not exceed degree 7. Because here I have already four of them. So then that means that I should have another three linear factors. And well, that means that the other linear factors correspond to the following zeros. So what's the complex conjugate of negative 2 plus 5i? The complex conjugate is going to be negative 2 minus 5i. So negative 2 minus 5i. What's the complex conjugate of negative 2i? Well, it's just positive 2i. And what's the conjugate of this irrational 0 here? Well, the conjugate is going to be 1 plus the square root of 3. And now this guy over here, this 8 does not come with a conjugate. It's only the complex zeros. So complex zeros always come in pairs. And irrational zeros also always come in pairs. Now, if you have a rational zero, like 8, that one can come alone. That one can just be alone, and that's okay. So my complex zeros come in pairs, conjugate pairs. My irrational solutions, my irrational zeros also come in conjugate pairs. But my rational zeros can stand alone. So these are the three other unknown zeros right here. Negative 2 minus 5i, 2i, and 1 plus square root of 3. Those are the other three zeros of this polynomial of degree 7. And now if you think about it, now all of this, so now I have 7 linear terms. I have these 4 linear terms that correspond to these 4 zeros. And then these other 3 zeros here would give me 3 more linear terms. And so then once you multiply everything, this 7 linear terms, you would end up with something x to the 7th. Okay, good. So just keep in mind that zeros correspond to linear factors, even if my zeros are complex numbers. Yeah, so it's just the linear factor is x minus the complex number. Definitely put a parenthesis around that complex number, because then you're going to have to distribute here the minus. All right, so hopefully these ideas are okay. So think about these next three problems. At this point, I would pause the video, I would read through these three problems and try to answer them on your own. And then let's just compare answers afterwards. Okay, so hopefully you pause the video, you get a chance to look at these three problems and have some solutions. Let's compare our answers. So for the first example, I need to find a polynomial function of degree 3 having zeros negative 4, 2, and negative 5. Okay, so I'm gonna call my polynomial function f of x. Now, since negative 4 is a 0, that means I gotta think now in terms of linear factors. Negative 4 being a 0 means that x plus 4 is a linear factor. The fact that 2 is a 0, that means that x minus 2 is a linear factor. The fact that negative 5 is a 0, that tells me that x plus 5 is a linear factor. And well, that is my polynomial of degree 3. I could just leave it like that if I wanted to at this point. I can just leave it, and this is in factor form. And this is a polynomial of degree 3. But just for the sake of a little bit of math practice here, I'm actually going to multiply this out. How do you multiply this out? Does the order in which I multiply matter? If I multiply x plus 4 times x minus 2, and then multiply the result of that times x plus 5, is that going to be different? Then if I start first by multiplying x minus 2 times x plus 5, and then the result of that multiply it by x plus 4. It turns out that the result doesn't matter. The order in which you multiply does not matter. It's a property of multiplication called associativity. So let's multiply this out. So I'm going to first multiply x plus 4 times x minus 2. And that would look like this. That would be x squared. And then I would have x times negative 2, that would be negative 2x plus 4x. So negative 2x plus 4x, that's going to give me positive 2x. So plus 2x and then minus 8. And all of this times x plus 5. Okay. Now let me continue with this multiplication here. Now what I gotta think about is something like this, x squared times x, that's x to the third, and then x squared times 5, that's 5x, sorry, 5x squared, so x squared times x, that's x to the third, x squared times 5, that's 5x squared. Now let me distribute 2x, 2x times x, that would be 2x squared, 2x times 5, that would be 10x. Okay, so I'm done with the 2x. Now let me distribute negative 8. Negative 8 times x, that would be negative 8x. And negative 8 times 5, that would be negative 40. And now I'm going to collect like terms and clean this up a little bit and write it in descending order. So x to the third. Now let me look at x squared. So that would be 7x squared. So plus 7x squared. Now let me think about x's. 10x minus 8x. That's plus 2x minus 40. Yeah? Either form is correct. You could leave it in factor form, or you could write it just as a third degree polynomial. It doesn't matter. Well, I guess maybe if you're doing homework in my math lab might want you to enter the solution as a, not in factor form, but as a polynomial form. Okay, so hopefully we agree on the first question. Let's move on to the next one. All right. For this next one, I'm supposed to find a polynomial of degree 3 having the zeros 1, 2 plus 3i, and its conjugate 2 minus 3i. Okay, well, it's similar in style to the previous question. Let's see, let's call the polynomial f of x. So since 1 is a 0, that means that x minus 1 is a linear factor. Since 2 plus 3i is a 0, that means that x minus 2 plus 3i is a linear factor, and another linear factor is going to be x minus 2 minus 3i. And now, this is, I guess in a sense, we're done here. This is a polynomial of degree 3 that has the zeros 1, 2 plus 3i and 2 minus 3i. But again, just to kind of do a little bit of exercise with multiplication here, I am going to multiply this out. Okay, so let's see. I am going to begin by doing the following. I'm going to say x minus 1 times, I'm going to distribute these negatives into my complex number. So that's going to look like this. X minus 2 minus 3i times x minus 2 plus 3i. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to begin by multiplying this trinomial, or this this middle term right here, this middle factor, times the rightmost factor. So I'm going to do the multiplication of x minus 2 minus 3i times x minus 2 plus 3i. And then once I'm done with that, I'll multiply by x minus 1. All right, so I'm gonna have x minus 1. I'm gonna do my scratch work over here on this side. I'm gonna do x minus 2 minus 3i times x minus 2 plus 3i. I'm gonna do it over here on the side, just so that I leave myself some room here. So let's see, x times x, well, that's x squared. And then I'm gonna have x times negative 2, that's minus 2x. And then x times 3i, well, that's 3xi. 3, or I'll say 3ix. So that's what happened if I multiply the x. So x times these three terms, x times x, x times negative 2, x times 3i. Now let me distribute this negative 2 right here. So negative 2 times x, that's going to be minus 2x. And then negative 2 times negative 2, that's going to be plus 4. And then negative 2 times 3i, that's going to be negative 6i. Okay, now let me distribute the negative 3i. So negative 3i times x, it's going to be negative 3ix, negative 3i times negative 2, that becomes positive 6i, and negative 3i times positive 3i is going to become negative 9i squared. But remember, keep in mind over here that I squared is equal to negative 1. Don't forget about that, yeah? So now it's a matter of collecting like terms. I don't have anything else with x squared over here. I don't have anything else with x squared. There's only one x squared, so I'm gonna have x squared. Now let me think about x's. One thing I notice here is that this 3ix and this negative 3ix are gonna cancel each other out. And I'm gonna have negative 2x minus 2x. Well, that's negative 4x, so minus 4x. So negative 2x and negative 2x, those were like terms. And then here I have some business of 6i minus 6i, those are canceling. And then I guess just constants, 4, and then this negative 9i squared. Negative 9i squared is like the same thing as saying plus 9. Plus 9, yeah, because remember I squared is negative 1. And negative 9 times negative 1 is positive 9. So plus 9. So I have 4 plus 9. I guess that's 13. Yeah? So that's how I multiplied this linear terms with complex roots, complex zeros. Yeah? Just gotta keep in mind that I squared is negative 1 and collect like terms. Okay? So now let me actually then finish this multiplication here. So now let me multiply x minus 1 times this polynomial of degree 2. So that's going to look something like this. Sorry, there's a little delay here with my erasing. So equals, and what I wanted to get rid of was this little parentheses. All right, so now I have x to the third. Why? Because x times x squared is x to the third. And then x times negative 4x, that's minus 4x squared, and then plus 13x. Notice what I'm doing here. I'm multiplying this x by everything else in my parentheses. So once I'm done with multiplying x, I move on to the other next term on the right and multiply by everything else in the parentheses on the right. So that's going to look like this, negative x squared plus 4x minus 13. And now let me just write down the cleanup version of this. Collect like terms. So this is x to the third minus 5x squared plus 17x minus 13. Yeah, this would be the format that my MATLAB would want you to enter your solution in. Just in polynomial form. All right, so hopefully we have agreed so far. Let's move on to the next one. I'm supposed to find a polynomial function of lowest degree. So the smallest degree possible with rational coefficients that has negative 1 and 5 minus 4i as two of its zeros. All right, well, let me come up with this polynomial of lowest degree. What is the degree going to be of this polynomial? I think the degree has to be 3. Why? Because, well, negative 1 is a 0. That corresponds to one linear factor. 5 minus 4i is another 0. That corresponds to a second linear factor. But then since 5 minus 4i is a 0, that means that its conjugate 5 plus 4i should also be a 0, so there should be 3 linear factors. So let me write them down. They're going to be x plus 1, x minus 5 minus 4i, and x minus 5 plus 4i. Those should be my three linear factors. Now let me actually go ahead and carry out the multiplication here. Here comes the tedious part. Let's see. So this is x plus 1 times x minus 5 plus 4i times x minus 5 minus 4i. Let me do my little multiplication of x. So over here on the side, x minus 5 plus 4i times x minus 5 minus 4i. Let me do this multiplication out here. So x squared minus 5x minus 4ix, and then minus 5x minus 5x plus 25 plus 25 plus 20i, and then 4ix 4ix minus 20 minus 20 I minus 16i squared. Okay, so again, keep in mind that I squared is negative 1, so what I should have is x plus 1 times x squared. So I have x squared. Now let me think about my x's. Definitely that, so this that cancels with that. This negative 20i cancels with this positive 20i. Okay, so that's great. So I should have x squared minus 10x minus 10x, and then I'm gonna have 25 plus 16. 25 plus 16, that's going to be 41. Okay, so that is what I get out of multiplying these two linear terms with complex numbers. Now let me carry out this multiplication here. So, all right, let's do it. So this is x to the third minus 10x squared plus 41x plus x squared minus 10x plus 41. Let me collect some like terms here. So x to the third minus 9x squared, 41 minus 10, that's 31, so plus 31x plus 41. Yeah, so hopefully we agree on that. Next problem, let's try it. Let's try this next little problem. So they told us that 1, 0 of this polynomial is negative 4. So this is a third degree polynomial and they gave me 1, 0. I gotta find the other two. I gotta find the other two zeros. I would definitely encourage you to pause the video at this moment and try this problem on your own. And my hint to you is use synthetic division. Maybe try to use some synthetic division or long division. That's my hint. All right, so hopefully you tried it and you found the other zeros of this polynomial. This polynomial should have three. There should be three zeros because it's a polynomial of degree 3. And the fundamental theorem of algebra guarantees that there's going to be three zeros. Okay, so how do I find the other two? I know that this one is a zero. How do I find the other two? I'm going to do some synthetic division. All right, so I'm gonna say this, negative 4, I have my polynomial, so 2, 13, 17, negative 12, okay? So 2 goes down here, we said negative 4 times 2, that's negative 8, 13 minus 8, 13 minus 8 is what? That's going to be, I don't know how to, so 13, that's going to be 5, so positive 5, and then negative 4 times 5, that's negative 20, 17 plus negative 20, that would be negative 3, negative 4 times negative 3, that's positive 12, and we have a remainder of 0. All right, so this is the quotient, we said, this is our quotient. So this is a quotient, This is our remainder. Our remainder should not be a surprise that it's zero. I mean, they already told us that negative 4 is a zero, so the remainder should be zero. So then that means that we have this quotient to deal with. 2x squared plus 5x minus 3. So think about what's going on now. What we have just now said is the following. Our polynomial p of x can be factored as x plus 4. Why do I know that it's x plus 4? Because they told me that negative 4 was a 0, so x plus 4 should be a linear factor. And now, through synthetic division, I know that I have this second degree polynomial, 2x to the second plus 5x minus 3. Okay, and so now I guess in order to find the other two zeros that we should have, we should look at this quadratic polynomial of degree 2, and see if we can factor it into linear terms. And for this, you can use factoring or the quadratic formula. Let's see if factoring works out here. Let's see. So I have x plus 4. So that's a linear factor. I want to see if I can just factor it by trial and error, although I'm not sure. We'll see. So I'm going to say 2x, x. That would give me 2x squared, okay? Now let me think here. I could have maybe a plus 3 right there, and maybe a minus 1 right there. Does that work? Let's see. 2x times x, that's 2x squared, and then 2x times 3, that would be 6x. And 6x minus x would give me this positive 5x, and then negative 1 times 3, that's negative 3, so I think this works. All right. So let's see, what I've done is I've just factored my polynomial into three linear terms. From this one right here, remember now what we have to do is set each one of the linear terms equal to zero. So I would have x plus 4 equals zero, which means that x equals negative 4 is one of the zeros. Here, if I set this equal to zero as well, so 2x minus 1 equals 0, solve this, this would say that x equals 1/2. And over here, if I set this equal to 0, this would say that x plus 3 equals 0, so x equals negative 3. So these are the two zeros that we were missing right here, yeah? Okay. So hopefully we agree on that. Synthetic division or long division is what helps us out here. We talked about that in the last video. All right, this next example is kind of strange. And in order to get into this next example, I want to tell you a little bit about what's called the rational zeros test. It's a little tool. It's a little antiquated tool, because now with the use of calculators, we don't really need this tool. But a long time ago, when people were trying to do this thing by hand, they had to think about these tools, yeah? And so then, let me just kind of mention to you this rational zeros test. What it says is the following. So if you're given a polynomial of degree n, so here's my polynomial of degree n, an x to the n, so on and so forth, all the way to a zero. Remember that this an here in my leading term, it's called the leading coefficient. And remember that the last term, the one that doesn't have an x, is called the constant coefficient. So I have the leading coefficient and the constant coefficient. All right, so if p over q, and assume that this fraction, p over q, is in lowest terms, what that means is that you've already reduced it, right? So it's already a reduced fraction. It cannot be reduced anymore. So that's what it means to be in lowest terms. So imagine that you have a fraction in lowest terms that is a zero of your polynomial. So you have some fraction in lowest terms that is a zero of your polynomial. Then what that means is that the numerator of that zero is a factor of the constant term. So the numerator is going to be some number that divides the constant term. And the denominator is going to be some number, it's going to be a factor of your leading coefficient. Yeah? And that is kind of surprising. That is kind of a big statement to say there. So if I have some fraction that is a zero of my polynomial, then the numerator is a zero. It's a factor of my constant term, and the denominator is a factor of my leading term. Yeah, this is called the rational zeros test. It allows you to find zeros, solutions to your polynomial equation, x-intercepts, that are of the form of a fraction. All right, so keep this in this rational zeros test in mind. And now you're given a function f of x, you're given a polynomial f of x. You gotta find all the rational zeros, find all the zeros, actually for that matter, and factor into linear factors your polynomial, yeah? And they give you a hint here to use your calculator to find the rational zeros first, yeah? So pause the video, see if you're up to the challenge. See if, so right now, literally the goal here is, can you factor these two polynomials into linear terms? Since this is a third degree polynomial, you should be able to factor it into three linear terms. Since this is a fourth degree polynomial, you should be able to factor it into four linear terms. Can you do it? Oops, sorry. There we go. Pause the video, try to do it on your own. All right, so hopefully you got some answers here. So let's see. All right, so I guess I'm faced with the challenge of having to factor this third degree polynomial into three linear terms. I'm gonna be thinking about this rational zeros test that I told you a second ago. So right now I know that the zeros, or actually I should say, let me erase here, if I can erase, oops. Sorry about the delay. My computer kind of gets a little bit slow once whenever I'm recording these videos. And it's hard to interact with OneNote, but we'll do our best here. Just bear with me here. I just want to erase this so that I can write rational zeros. I want to find the rational zeros of this part A first. If I can do that, because now I'm locked between an eraser and a red pen. I want either just one or the other, not both of them. Sorry again, I'm trying to just erase here. I don't know what the heck is going on. Bear with me. We're experiencing a bit of a technical difficulty here. Yeah, we wanna erase. Or not. I mean, we can always just go down. Huh? There we go. Alright, so let's see, let's make this happen. So rational zeros. All right, so they're of the form P over Q, yeah? And remember, P is supposed to be a divisor of your constant term. So I guess it's going to be, I should not use that key because it kind of makes my computer get stuck. So these are factors of negative 6. So that's my constant term over here. And the denominator should be the factors of my leading coefficient. So the leading coefficient of this polynomial is 1. So these are factors of 1. Okay, so let me, now I'm gonna use my calculator because I don't wanna start, so how am I gonna use my calculator to make this happen? So let's see, let's turn on the calculator. I'm gonna clear whatever I have going on. I'm gonna enter my polynomial into my y equals scenario here. So let me clear whatever I had before. So I have x to the third, let me move down, plus 3x to the second. Okay, minus 2x, all right, and minus 6, enter. So that's my polynomial of degree 3, and I'm gonna start trying to find some of the rational zeros here. So I don't wanna look at the graph. I'm actually gonna go to the table. I'm gonna hit second table, yeah? And now let me start thinking. So we said that the possible rational zeros were of the form P over Q, where the numerators were all the factors of negative 6, so things that divide negative 6, and the denominator is supposed to be factors of 1, things that divide 1. Well, that's easy, it's just going to be plus or minus 1. So let's see, what are possible fractions that I could get out of all of this? So I could have something like 1 over 1, 2 over 1, 3 over 1, 6 over 1, or I could also have negative 1 over 1, negative 2 over 1, negative 3 over 1, negative 6 over 1. These are all possibilities. If you think about it, 2 is a factor of negative 6, negative 2 is also a factor of negative 6, 3 is a factor of negative 6, negative 3, so 1, 2, 3, 6, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 6. Those are possible, those could be some of my zeros for this polynomial. So I'm gonna test them. So I'm gonna test 1. So right now I'm looking at this little list that I made. Is 1 a 0? So 1. Is 1 a 0 of my polynomial? No, because the y is negative 4. So let me start marking them off. So this is not a 0. This guy's not a 0. All right, let me test another 0. 2, is 2 a 0? So let me hit 2. No, 2 is not a 0 because the y is 10. So 2 is not a 0. So 2 is not a 0. What about 3? Is 3 a 0? Let's see, let's hit enter, let's enter 3. 3 is not a 0 because the y value is 42. So 3 comma 1, or 3 over 1 is not a 0. What about 6? Is 6 a 0? So is 6 a 0 of my polynomial? Nope, nope, it's not, because my y value is 306. So that's not a 0. Let me continue down this way using my calculator to test. Is negative 1 a 0? So let's see, negative 1. No, negative 1 is not a 0 because the y is negative 2. So this is not a 0. What about negative 2? Is negative 2 a 0? No, negative 2 is not a 0 because the y value is 2. So that's not a 0. What about negative 3? Negative 3. Is it a 0? Yes. Negative 3 is a 0 of my polynomial. So that one's good. What am I doing here? What the heck is going on? So this is good. That's a 0. Okay, so far so good then. We have found 1 0. So let's see, let's say the following. So negative 3 is a 0. Again, this rational zeros test allows you to make an educated guess as to what your zeros could be, instead of just guessing nilly-willy without any reason. At least now you know that there's a tool, it's called the rational zeros test, that allows you to make some fractions, and those fractions are possibilities of zeros. Turns out that we found one. Negative 3 is a 0. So negative 3 is a 0 of my polynomial. I just figured that I just used my table in my calculator to evaluate. Okay, and now I'm going to find the other two zeros by doing synthetic division. All right, so I found 1 0. Now let me do some synthetic division here. So I'm gonna say, okay, so I know that negative 3 is a 0. So let me set it up. So negative 3, we have 1, 3, negative 2, negative 6. So 1, that's negative 3, that's 0, 0, negative 2, that's positive 6, and 0. Okay, so right now I'm after the quotient. The quotient is x squared minus 2. Yeah, x squared minus 2, or I mean, it's x squared plus 0x, So this is my quotient. Okay, so that's good. Why is that good? Because now what I can do, I'm gonna just go down here, is I can say, so let me put, so this is the first thing I did, this is the second thing I did, this is the third thing that I'm gonna do. Now I can say that my polynomial f of x is equal to x plus 3. Why is it x plus 3? Because we figured out that negative 3 was a 0. So x plus 3 is a linear factor times x squared minus 2. Yeah? So that's what I know right now about my polynomial. And so then we need to, x plus 3 is already a linear term. X squared minus 2 is not linear. We need to factor that further. We need to factor that into two linear terms. So how are you going to do that? You could use the quadratic formula if you wanted to. Right now, the easier maybe approach here is to notice that this thing is called a difference of squares. So I have a perfect square minus something that doesn't look like a perfect square, but actually can be put in, made, you can think about anything as a perfect square. So then let me just show you what the factorization is going to look like here. So x plus 3 times x plus the square root of 2, sorry, times x minus the square root of 2. That's how this x squared minus 2 factors. It factors as x plus the square root of 2 times x minus the square root of 2. All right, and so then if you notice, right now what ended up happening is that I ended up, so my zeros, so the zeros are negative 3. Hey, sorry, my computer is kind of being stupid. So negative 3, square root of 2, and negative square root of 2. Yeah? Remember that these are irrational zeros. That's why they come in pairs. That's why they're conjugate pairs. All right, so that's kind of tedious. But it gets the job done. I mean, we really actually don't even need the calculator to do this. The calculator just makes the evaluation a little bit easier. All right, so let me kind of, if you want to at this point, if you haven't tried the next problem, pause the video, try it on your own, and then let's compare answers. It's very similar to the previous one. Okay, hopefully maybe at this point you already have solutions. Let's go through the process here. So something similar. The first thing I'm going to do is identify some rational zeros. And again, they're going to be of the form P over Q. And it's actually identical to the previous exercise that we did. So the numerators are going to be factors of the constant term, so 6, factors of 6, and my denominators are going to be factors of my leading coefficient. Okay, so then the list of possibilities, the list of our zeros are going to be the same as this list that we made earlier. So I'm going to say same as previous example. Okay, so let me get my calculator now, and let me just move my calculator over here to the side so we can see the problem. There we go. I'm going to go to my plot over here. I'm going to erase what I have here. I'm going to enter this new polynomial because this is a polynomial of degree 4. So x to the fourth plus 2x squared plus 2x to the 3. Minus 5x squared minus 5x to the second minus 4x plus 6. All right, enter. That's my polynomial. Let me go back to the table because that's what I'm interested in. Oh, look, I don't even have to enter them because I entered some x values earlier. So for instance, I already know that 1 is a 0, so 1 is a 0, another 0 is negative 3, yeah, So 1 is a possible 0 for my polynomial, negative 3 is a 0, so I'm gonna kind of use those. So we know that, let me write that down here. So we said that 1 is a 0, or let me, 1 and negative 3 are zeros. So 1 and negative 3 are zeros of my polynomial. All right. So then let's see. So then let me start thinking about how this is going to factor. So I'm sort of going to step into getting to step 3 here. So f of x is going to be x minus 1. That's because 1 is a factor, times x plus 3. And now I need to look for some other factor that, I mean, if you think about it, this is a polynomial of degree 4, so this factor here should be quadratic. How do I find it? How do I find that factor? Well, it turns out that I can use maybe some long division here. Long division. Or you could also use repeated synthetic division. You could use repeated synthetic division. That would also work. It doesn't matter. Here you're going to have to use some form of division in order to find the piece that you're missing here. So let's see. I know that x minus 1, well, let me multiply this out. This becomes x squared plus 2x minus 3. That would be if I actually multiply these two linear terms. And so then what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide my fourth degree polynomial by this second degree polynomial so that I can find the other polynomial. The quotient is what I'm after here. So let's see, I'm gonna do it in black ink. So this is going to go like this. X squared plus 2x minus 3 divides this fourth degree polynomial, x to the fourth plus 2x to the third minus 5x squared minus 4x plus 6. Let's see. So this is going to be x squared. It has to be x squared, so that becomes x to the fourth. And then x squared times 2x, well, that's 2x to the third. And then x squared minus 3, well, that's negative 3x squared. And then we gotta do minus, so that's 0, because x to the fourth minus x to the fourth, that's 0. 2x cubed minus 2x cubed, that's 0, so 0. And then negative 5x squared plus 3x squared, that's going to be negative 2x squared. And then I bring down minus 4x. And I could bring down the plus 6 as well, actually. And now I gotta think to myself, so here I gotta say now minus 2. So negative 2 times 2x. So negative 2 times x squared, sorry, that's negative 2x squared, and then negative 2 times 2x, that's going to be negative 4x, and then negative 2 times negative 3, that's positive 6, and then we have to do minus, and our remainder is 0. Yeah, so then that means that this other polynomial that we were looking for over here is x squared minus 2, x squared minus 2. Yeah. And okay, so the final answer here. So let's write it in linear factor form. So it's x minus 1 times x plus 3 times x plus the square root of 2 times x minus the square root of 2. Those are the four linear terms of this polynomial. Yeah, we definitely had to use a calculator to find a couple of them. We figured out that 1 was a 0. And negative 3 was a 0. Based on that, I had to find the other two by using long division, or you can also use repeated synthetic division. All right, so that is it for this this section. I know it's a lengthy sort of section, but it's interesting stuff. So Okay, thank you. I'll see you in the next video.